I never quite know exactly what I'm going to say to start off a talk like this, and I always listen to what people say as an intro, and I think one thing needs to be said before I begin, and that is I'm a Roman Catholic, Irish, Polish guy from Keene, New Hampshire. You heard the background of here I am now in this position of coordinator of educational outreach at Keene State College. You should know that at the Cohen Center, our faculty and members are Protestant and Catholic, which raises an interesting question. In this most solemn of months, in April, why is it that a Roman Catholic guy would be speaking about the Holocaust? And I think it's pretty simple to kind of delineate that reason and why I think we are so focused on what we do. 99% of those who were the persecutors of Jews in the Second World War were baptized Catholics, or Catholics, Christians, I'm sorry, baptized Christians, Catholic, Protestant. When the studies of the Holocaust first began, really in earnest in the 1960s and 70s, it was really an event focused for the Jewish community, for children trying to explore what happened to their parents, to try to get some kind of grasp of what this history was. And many said, this is a topic we can't even touch. It is so horrific. Enough has been said. And at that point, Yaffa Eliach, who made the Tower of Life in Washington, if you've been to the museum there, was telling me that in her first classes, 99% or more of the students were Jewish. And it was striking to us in Keene that when the center was created in 1983, Professor Hildebrand went to the vice president and said, we need to have a center here. And the first response was, but Chuck, you're not Jewish. He said, I know. 99% of the persecutors were baptized Christians. In other words, who should study this event? The Jewish community needs to. They have to find what happened. They've got to somehow recreate those roots that have been taken away from them. On the other hand, if we as educators are to share any message from this event, I think who has to be studying it are the potential bystanders and perpetrators of the events. You'll see this as the presentation goes along. I'll ask you to sort of brainstorm, if you don't know, what the percentage of Jews were in 1933 Germany as a percent of the population. I'll also tell you when I go out into middle schools and high schools what they say they think the percentage was. And you'll see what I'm getting at. So with that in mind, I'm going to just sort of dive right in. And my presentation today really is going to take us from, first of all, I guess now, defining some kind of, I guess, short-term definition of what the Holocaust was, if that can do justice to it. We'll break that down just a little bit, and then I'll get into the early years of oppression from 1933 to 38 as my major focus today, and look at where human rights were violated. And if we are to learn anything to project this in our world today, that's our only hope, I think. We know what happened. We now know the antecedents of persecution, and that's human rights violations. If we can identify what happened from 33 to 38, we'll have a wonderful blueprint of when to react. By 1938, it's too late. By 1933, you definitely could have done something, and I'll mention that throughout the show. Let's define the Holocaust. The state-sponsored systematic persecution and annihilation of European Jewry by Nazi Germany and its collaborators from 1933 to 1945. I'll break it down for you a little bit. First of all, you'll notice that I've got 1933 in parentheses. It's the sort of the canonical time to define the Holocaust, but it doesn't really work for us because the Holocaust in earnest doesn't really take place until really 1941 to 45. In October of 1941, we have no evidence, but we have no direct paper trail, but from all the orders that were issued, it's pretty conclusive that in October of 41, the order was given to gas Jews in those death camps. And the orders went out, they found the sites, they started building them. Previous to that, German troops were shooting Jewish communities in Eastern Europe up to 2.5 million that summer, before the gas chamber became the final solution, right? So the date 33 is when Hitler comes to power, but to assume that the Holocaust was inevitable from 1933 onward is to misunderstand what happened. Nothing was inevitable. In fact, there were many twists and turns along the way, as Carl Schlonis writes in his book, The Twisted Road to Auschwitz, where it could have gone in many different directions. In fact, it's pretty clear that when Hitler faced any kind of popular opposition to his policies, he stopped them in their tracks. He was a very savvy politician who took daily popular opinion polls. The Gestapo would go out and they would basically find out what people thought in the pubs. You know, they'd go, they wouldn't be in their black leather jackets. They'd be dressed like anybody going to the pub. And they said, what do you think of what was just going on? Every day they would make a report back to Hitler about popular opinion. So we'll see this develop throughout this entire presentation. You'll also notice here, and I saw people nod their head, and I was glad to see that, where you see collaborators. Again, this is often defined as a German problem, right, that Germans did this. And in Daniel Goldhagen's book, Hitler's Willing Executioners, he basically makes that supposition that Germans are basically born with sort of this original sin of hating and wanting to kill Jews. It's a poorly researched book. It's not backed up very well. In fact, he's not even a historian. And it's a very misleading and dangerous book, because now it says you can hate, and you can hate Germans, which dismisses all those Germans who resisted the Nazis. In fact, one, Martin Niemöller, who was the pastor in a Berlin church, who was an active opponent of Hitler, I met his widow about 4 weeks ago. And her cousin was the one who brought the bomb into Hitler's bunker in 1944. Okay, so with Goldhagen making these sweeping, unsupported accusations that all Germans are evil, you have these dangerous tendencies to make these sweeping conclusions. And they're not always right. It makes us feel very comfortable. I can hate Germans, therefore don't have to look at my own responsibility as to what happened. And Goldhagen is made a fortune on that particular thing. He's become a millionaire, which makes us kind of, I guess, bothered by it all. So systematic persecution, state-sponsored. It was government-sponsored. PhDs sat down and figured out how they were going to do it at the very, very end. So again, the state was directly involved in what was going to happen. Now, the Holocaust was unprecedented. We get into a discussion now about genocide versus the term the Holocaust, capital H. And in our world, the Holocaust is a term that now has sort of been grabbed on by everyone. Persecution is widespread on our planet today. When we're talking about this event, though, capital H, we're talking about this specific event of what happened to the Jewish European community because of Nazi Germany and its collaborators. By unprecedented, I mean this. Genocide is as old as the hills. But what happened here was quite different. The goals for the Holocaust, unlike other genocides, and this is not a comparison of who suffered more. If someone gets persecuted or their human rights are violated, they suffer. End of story. We cannot do a comparative guilt analysis here. But what we're trying to do is identify what in the Holocaust was unique and different. And unique probably isn't the right word. I think unprecedented is a better word. Its goals for Jews were global and universal. Hitler had a blueprint for world conquest. We now have found the plans of his plans to invade the United States, for example. He was going to invade Switzerland, and on it would go. The goals for the Jewish world was all Jews globally were to be exterminated. Globally. Other genocides tend to be geographically limited. If you go to the Balkans, you don't see Slobodan Milosevic and the Serbs coming to America to kill Muslims, or Bosnians, or Albanians, right? It is limited to ethnic conditions, to history, to geography. Same thing in Rwanda, right? That isn't taking place outside of that ethnic conflict area. So the genocide takes place there and is usually narrowly defined to that area. The Holocaust was meant and intended to be globally. All Jews were targeted to be exterminated. Its intended totality, again, is what we're getting here at. And if you see this image, if you know anything about the images here, I think you can guess what's happening here, right? I mean, we're talking, I don't use imagery that much like this. First of all, I can't deal with it on a personal level. You've heard Saul say, I have two sons of my own. I love them dearly. There are images I just can't take. This is as close as I guess I can get. This is Hungarian Jews leaving the Birkenau. They've come in off the railway track. They've been separated. You'll notice that women and children are there. In a way, you know they're Hungarian Jews because, first of all, they've got the Star of David on them in Auschwitz. So you know that Auschwitz has already been built and that somewhere in a different country that process of labeling them has taken place. They also are carrying their own clothing and are relatively well fed. Hungarian Jews, Elie Wiesel's story at night, they were relatively isolated until the end of the war when the Germans found out that there were 250,000 Hungarians that they hadn't dealt with. And with its global and total mission, they had to kill them before the war ended. And here they are coming in, and of course they're walking to the gas chamber. They don't know it. When I show this image, my question always is, not so much what the image is, but who took the photograph? And as a young father, and I, of course, it's nice my dad being here. It's a special treat from Florida. There's a picture of my brother and I on our in our downstairs of he and I skating, you know, the local pond. And as a young kid, I used to love that picture. Here's my brother passed away a few years ago. And I used to look at that picture, look at my brother and I. When I became a father, my whole perspective changed. I look at that photo and I say, why did my dad take that picture of his two boys at that time? What was he seeing as a father? I think of that imagery and I think, what was the fellow thinking of here when he took this photograph? What was he trying to savor? What moment was he trying to remember? And of course, he was very proud of what he was doing. I think the best way to approach this is to not go to those images. I started yesterday, I had a talk yesterday to some folks, and I said, when you think of Holocaust and you think of Jew, what images come to mind? In fact, maybe I'll just ask you that. Let's just play a little word association or imagery, I guess. Holocaust and Jew, what images come to mind? Go ahead, I'm sorry. Kristallnacht, November of 38, when the synagogues and stores are being attacked. What else? Death, gas chambers. What do people look like? And if I show those images to high school or middle school kids, they can be morally outraged. They can sit there and say, that's awful. Right? And they can say, oh, isn't that, look at this human suffering, that's terrible. And then they go home to their families and have dinner. If I say the same thing about perpetrators, describe for me perpetrators of the Holocaust, right? Tell me, Holocaust Nazi, what imagery do you see? Of course, you know where I'm heading here, right? You see the brown-shirted SA, you see the SS, you know, you see the black-booted leather jacket people beating people up. But do you see the nurses at the Hadamar Hospital who are gassing handicapped people before the Holocaust began? Do you see the average person, right, is what I'm trying to get at. If I use these iconic imageries of perpetrator and victim, the person viewing my presentation instantly says, thank goodness I'm not either one of them. And they've taken a nice main street path of safety where they're not confronted with anything except personal moral outrage. That's wonderful, but it hasn't achieved anything. If we're going to get anything here, I think we have to go before 1933. We have to look at the humanity of the victims, who they were as people. And so here is a mother and her daughter in France, just before the war, victims of the Holocaust. Or if we look at these German girls, here in Nuremberg in 1929, of course, Nuremberg, you know, the great rally spots for the Nazis, right? And here they are, victims of the Holocaust. If I show this imagery, especially to the students that I'm talking to and working with, suddenly these pictures become very similar to their own. They have pictures of their girlfriends and boyfriends and their mom and dads and all that. And suddenly I had some fellows, some boys in upstate New Hampshire. They came in, oh yes, the Holocaust. Oh, are we going to see any gruesome pictures the whole bit, you know? And to their great disappointment, there were no gruesome pictures. There were these pictures. They left in tears. But one mistake I think most people make is that somehow Jew or Jews is sort of this monolithic entity, right? That in Europe, in 1933, Hitler declared war on the Jew, whatever that might have been, right? But of course, the Jewish community is as diverse as, I guess, Christianity is. When you have Protestant, Catholic, and then all the different diversions and sects there, Judaism is very, very similar. In fact, so much so that European Jews, especially German Jews, did not really like Eastern European Jews. Traditional, Orthodox, isolated Jews were much different than the assimilated Western European Jews. So there was not this sort of Jewish identity that Nazis could attack, which of course will be problematic for them as they decide that Jews are the enemy of the state. We go to Central Europe now, Hungary on the left. This is the lake around Budapest. As I showed this slide the other day, one of the fellows at Keene State, his family was from there. And he had not seen that photograph. And of course, these connections always happened to come up. Or these little school kids here. And again, if you look at the imagery here and you look at the pictures and who took them, the future is a bright and happy place. The father is taking a picture maybe of it, or actually the mother probably here. Here he is at the beach. It's a lovely day. The future's full of hope. I want these pictures for some future memory looking back on these wonderful days. Nobody knew what was coming. In fact, if you asked anybody, well, maybe in 1920, and you said, here's what the Holocaust is, a term defined after the Second World War, where would it most likely have taken place? The last answer you would have had was Nazi Germany. Well, actually, Germany, right? It wouldn't have happened there. Most progressive state, Jews were assimilated. They would have said, do you know where are the two places that probably would have happened? They would have said, France. Poland maybe, and Russia, right? Russia and France, right? Poland being part of that, especially you know, the northeastern part of Poland, especially. But no one would be thinking about Germany. I show these little boys because guess what? Two little boys, look at the age difference, little Tokyo. This one always reminds me of my two little boys. And it always, here they are going swimming again. These are victims of the Holocaust, okay? And I show that for myself. Before I get into a presentation, I want to make sure why I'm doing it. And it's because of my boys, I think. We get down to a basic concept here. Why do people hate to even begin with here? We have this Hitler Youth picture, basically all 10-year-olds to the Fuhrer kind of thing, the imagery here. And what I would do usually is simply say, we'll figure out why people hate, but also how do political leaders use that hatred? And I'm going to give you sort of this running list of reasons why people hate. We all know them. But I need to have them in the back of your mind somewhere as I present this, because somewhere here, these are all going to emerge somewhere between 33 and 38. Fear, you know, Germany in the 1930s was a place that had gone through an economic depression. You know, the war had devastated the country. Then there was recovery. In the middle of years, Germany started to come back. Then there was the Great Depression that took away all hope. It's often missed that there was hope in Germany in the 1920s. Things were coming back. And it's that devastated second depression, where hope was destroyed for a second time, that Germans began to despair. You must also, I think, keep in context, and this is true with the Catholic Church also at the time, that the Communist Revolution had taken place in Eastern Europe in 1917. What were they doing from 1917 to 1933? Except expropriating a lot of property from landowners, killing a lot of people. In Europe, they were terrified of a similar thing happening in Europe. German political life, no matter what political party you were in, it had to be a standard track that you were going to preserve the country from outside influence. Even despite that, in Germany, the Communist Party became one of the largest parties in Germany, which to most Germans signaled the very threat that they were afraid of. The communists are coming, the communists are coming. Now, for all those who say, well, that's rather bizarre and silly, look at America at the same time. The Red Scares that were going on and would continue after the Second World War in this country also. So you have a similar sort of dynamic. What made it different? We'll have to figure that out as we go along. So you have fear of outside influence, especially communism. The Catholic Church, the Pope at the time, was a young priest witnessing the Russian Revolution. He was motivated by that absolute fear of them taking over church property and destroying the church, as were Germans in Central Europe. Ignorance, prejudice, feeling threatened, I think is a huge one. Jealousy, us versus them. Let's see how these all kind of play out. And I show you this because I have to show you the guys of what I do. There's a very famous image of the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising where a little boy is raising his hands. You know, they've been cleaning out the last bunker and here are the German soldiers with machine guns as they're going there. And people love that image because they show the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising through that image. Well, I would like to put that image to you if you are a middle school or high school male. And what do you see? You see power. You have a fellow with a machine gun making a family cringe in terror. Columbine High School? The imagery that one projects in using the Holocaust can in fact be self-destructive. If I only show that image and I say, look at the persecution of Jews, that's not the message kids receive. They receive, if you have a gun, you have power over people who can't resist. In fact, the Holocaust is often taught out of context. People forget that World War II is happening. It was that very war that Hitler said, under the guise of war, I can kill a lot of people and get away with it. But at the very end, what was the result of all those prejudices and hatreds and things that made you hate? You must put it in context. At the end, the Germans get annihilated. Their cities are destroyed. That's the end result of that kind of thought process. So if you begin to hate because of fear or ignorance or jealousy or all those kind of different motives, the end result of those kind of decisions will be this. Your personal life or national life will end up as a ruin. The other, I guess, important pre-element to all of this was the history of anti-Judaism and anti-Semitism that was prevalent in Europe. It isn't, I guess, it's an easy thing to say that because there was historical anti-Jewish feeling and anti-Semitism that led to the Holocaust. No. What you can say is a groundwork was there where Hitler's ideology could use it to his advantage. Hitler was no fool. He was a very brilliant politician. When he had in his mind, I want to take on Jews, he tapped into European traditions that made people do the things he wanted them to do. To define the terms anti-Judaism, you'll notice a hyphen, and anti-Semitism, no hyphen. To define, it's an important distinction, I think. First of all, anti-Judaism is basically, you can go back to pre-Christianity, to the ancient world, it's there, it exists. Why? Well, Judaism was the first belief in one God. A God who also had ethical expectations of the people who believed in him. But for the ancient world, that was polytheistic, whose gods did not have an ethical imperative. This is quite different. It's as different as group A versus group B, and it's a natural social tendency to say they are different, and therefore you have tension. It did not necessarily mean no violence. Many in the ancient world were intrigued by Jewish ideas, and others saw them as the other. It's a natural social phenomenon. For 2,000 years in European Christendom, anti-Judaism was a rife weapon for people who wanted really to deflect people's anger or aggression or whatever onto a separate group other than those in power. And so anti-Judaism was a very potent force. Anti-Semitism, a 19th century idea of racism based on social Darwinism, a spread from that, applying it, you may or may not know the history, is about race. That Jews aren't necessarily a religion, but a race. And from that, we'll see how that develops with Nazi ideology. Let's go back to sort of the destructive Christian myths that were going to be used by Hitler, and by the way, are still currently being used today. And first of all, the most destructive one is the idea of deicide, Jews as Christ killers. This is a 15th century German mosaic tile, what's left of it. And what you see, of course, is Jesus with the halo on the cross being nailed to the tree by men with funny-looking hats. In 1215, at the Fourth Lateran Council, 1215, the year of the Magna Carta, Jews were also, for the first time in Europe, forced to wear distinctive clothing and badges to identify them as separate and distinct from Christians in Europe to prevent sexual relations. Antecedents of what was going to happen later on? Sure, groundwork has been laid. When you see these kind of imagery, where you have Jews killing Christ, you have a powerful religious myth that is accepted. In fact, when you're attacking Jews, you're not attacking Jews, you're attacking devil's agents, who of course will undermine God. To see how Hitler would take advantage of these kind of pre-existing myths and notions that were deeply rooted in Europe, this is from The Poisonous Mushroom, a book that most school kids would get in Nazi Germany. And basically, I'll say here, groundwork for the moral exclusion of Jews was laid in the centuries preceding the Holocaust. And from the book, you see here Jesus on the cross. You see the good-looking German kids, you know, looking up at this as good Christians would. And the page reads, basically, when you see a cross, then think of the horrible murder by the Jews on Golgotha. Now, it's interesting in that I'm a Catholic, and we're now in Passion Week, Holy Week, that I can remember as a young child going through and reciting the narratives. When Jesus is being crucified, the crowd responds, "May his blood be on us and on all our descendants." In other words, we Jews killed Christ. And if you are a practicing Christian, that's simply something you have to accept as a reality. Now, of course, since 1962 and 63, the Catholic Church has taken a look at historical anti-Semitism, anti-Jewish feeling, and have written some texts saying we were wrong. Where I differ, where I think problems begin, is when the Pope, for example, in his great humility, went to Yad Vashem in Jerusalem, and he knelt down and said, "Please forgive us for our 2,000 years of sinning against our religious brothers, Jews." There's a problem for me in that. For in that kind of apology, which is where the Catholic Church, in my view, should begin to examine its own prejudices, we were asking of people who were victimized to forgive us? That all the onus was on them to forgive their own persecution? What I believe is that we as individuals should sort of look at our own lives. Rather than asking our victim to forgive us, we have to forgive ourselves first and find out what we do next. So I want to show you here how Hitler used the imagery. If you've seen the famous film by Leni Riefenstahl, Triumph of the Will, where Hitler flies in over Nuremberg, and he flies in over the church steeples, and the bells are ringing, and here he descends from the heavens, comes down as the new savior. The Christian imagery is incredibly strong. So most German Christians saw him as, in a way, their Messiah. And when Hitler began to use traditional anti-Christian feeling, many people felt very comfortable in adopting what Hitler was saying. From the Fourth Lateran Council, here we are, our badges. Again, this is our gold, perhaps coins, we're not quite sure, but that's probably your best interpretation of Jews being made to wear them by King Philip Auguste as he drives Jews out. Again, when Hitler brings in the yellow badges, it's not anything new no one was shocked or surprised by this. In fact, when we talk about the final solution, we're talking about the end of a sort of a three-phase development in Nazi ideology. The first plan for Jews in Nazi Germany was deportation. They wanted them to leave the country. Well, that falls back on a very ancient European tradition of making Jews leave. These are some of the deportation areas in Europe in the Middle Ages, of course. And to quote Martin Luther, a former Catholic monk, leader of the Protestant Reformation, and again, you can't quote things in little brief contexts, you know, and say, oh, look, there it is. But he has written many tracts. In fact, Hitler himself was very fond of quoting Luther. And in fact, Kristallnacht began coincidentally on Luther's birthday. But that was, I think, more of an accident of fate. But to quote Luther, a man of his time, everything must be in context. He said, let me give you my honest advice about Jews. First, their synagogues or churches should be set on fire, and whatever does not burn up should be covered or spread over with manure so that no one may ever be able to see a cinder of it. And this ought to be done for the honor of God and Christianity. So that's the European medieval mindset here. And putting him in context, it's no great surprise that Luther himself became a great anti-Semite. After all, these were Christ killers who were denying the word of God, who refused to be saved. We jump ahead now. Before we get into Hitler and the Nazis, let's, I guess, dispel some myths that are out there. This seems to be the common one, that Hitler was elected to power in 1933 in Germany, and that is not true. So let's look at the context. Here he is, Hitler, with his cabinet. You'll notice he's not wearing a military uniform. He's trying to play the role of politician, which will be incredibly important in that year of 1933, as you'll see events unfold. But what is the context of what happened in 1933? And I've mentioned it already. Fear of communism is the overriding, I think, most important factor that happens in Germany in 1933. When Germany broke up at the end of the First World War, Rosa Luxemburg, reluctantly, and other communist leaders in Germany staged a coup to try to overthrow the German state. That was a communist revolution at the time of the Russian Revolution. Germans remembered that. It was instantly put down by the German army, and there it was, but it always lingered there. And as the economy went into crisis in 1928 and 29, your extremist parties, on the right the Nazis, on the left the communists, began to get more and more votes, and they're almost seen in direct opposition to each other. So communism, the fear of it, was a driving, motivating factor for most Germans at that time. From 1930 to 32, democracy actually had failed to work anyway in Germany. When Hitler is given power in 33 and begins to rule by decree, it had already been done for two previous years. What he did was not at all new or stunning to Germans. That's how the government had to run, because the democracy had failed to function. So using Article 48 of the Constitution, which basically said you can rule by decree in times of emergency, chancellors before Hitler had done the same thing to try to save the economy. And of course, the role of political intrigue. Basically, how it breaks down is, here was Hitler, a man who had an SA army of thugs who would willingly beat up communists on the street. A German army that was limited by the Treaty of Versailles couldn't do that. Those in power said, we need to bring someone in who can take up the communist threat. Here is a guy who never graduated high school, who is, in some people, some circles, a raving lunatic. We'll get him into power, we'll use his SA brown-shirted army to take out the communists, and then we'll get rid of Hitler. That was basically the plan. What they did not realize, of course, that this man was ruthless. And when he came to power, he got rid of them. Now, the NSDAP, or Nazi for short, was a very unique phenomenon in Germany. You must understand that there were many political parties, and I'm not just saying that in that there was a plurality of democracy. What happened here was, historically in Germany, every political party had its own very narrowly defined constituency. You had, for example, a party that represented Catholics. You had a party that represented workers. You had and it goes on. There are 70 some odd parties with a very narrow constituency, all polling 3 or 4% of the vote. And when it was all said and done, most likely the leading figure who rallied the most votes might be named chancellor by the president. The chancellor was not directly elected by the populace, but was appointed by the president. I mentioned if you have 20% of the vote in Germany, you are in fact a significant party because of the diversity of political parties. What the Nazis did with their bizarre title of the National Socialist German Workers' Party, that looked weird to Germans as it does to us. You can't be a nationalist and a socialist at the same time, for socialists are international. And most people said, what is this party? We look back and say the same thing and just call it Nazi, it's easier. But what he was saying is, we're going for votes outside of a narrow constituency. It's the first time in German politics that was ever done. It's your first truly national party. And began to galvanize votes across the German populace. Well, look at what happened. 1928, Nazis poll 800,000 votes, 12 seats in the Reichstag. They're a minority party, but an important one, polling a very small percentage of votes. 1929, the Great Crash, and the 1930 election results, Social Democrats, or if you would, the mainstream Weimar Republic government, 143 seats, but look, Nazis, communists, you can see what happened. 6.5 million votes, 107 seats, 18.3%, a major significant party. Why? The Great Depression. Here was a party that had an answer, that could solve our problems. Communists, though, offered another radical solution and therefore got a number of votes also. By 1932, Hindenburg and Hitler, I guess, said it's time, although he debated it, to run against Hindenburg, the standing president, for power. He debated it, was unsure to do it or not. He did it. He lost. People thought his career was over. Hindenburg had 19 million votes, but Hitler got 14 million votes, except notice his party had 6.5 million votes in 1930. And now they're thinking we have 14 million votes. They are swelling with more and more power. But it's to be noted, by the end of 1932, by July, you'll notice the Nazis polling 37.3% of the vote, now an incredibly significant party in German politics. By the end of the year, by November, they've lost 2 million votes. They're now down to 33.1%. And in fact, most polling showed the Nazi Party is about to fall off the map. Why? Hitler kept promising everything to everyone. He would go to a business meeting and say, I will destroy all unions and make sure that there's a, you know, there's no tax on corporate income and that kind of stuff, right? He would then go to the workers and he would say, we are going to give you union rights and equality and take away the money from the rich and blah, blah, blah. He would tell everybody what they wanted to hear. Well, that gets you so far until people start talking to each other and all the contradictions begin to come out. And when you had SA brown-shirted thugs beating people up on the streets, it didn't really play well in a German population that loved law and order above all. Now, to illustrate that, I don't want to be stereotypical here, but there are a couple of nice illustrations of that. When the Germans, the Nazis come to power and begin to arrest their opponents, there's a very funny story that takes place. There's a story of a fellow running through a park in some German city, and the Gestapo are chasing him. They come to this beautifully manicured park. The lawn is nicely cut with a nice sign that says, don't walk on the grass. Right? And the Gestapo are after this guy. The guy runs for his life, probably over the grass. The Gestapo ran to it, read the sign, stopped, and ran down the path. Germans like law and order. In fact, they were going to bargain their freedom away for that very commodity. The Weimar Republic was a place of incredible chaos, social disorder, terrible filmmaking, homosexuality, drug abuse. Something had to be done to rescue ourselves from our own problems. We needed a radical solution to bring back law and order. When I talked to a rescuer, Marion Pritchard, who some of you may know, she lives in Vermont. She was a Dutch rescuer whose story is a remarkable one. She was hiding a Jewish family really in the floor of her house when the German police showed up with a Dutch police officer. They came to the door, she hid them, they were safe. The Germans left, they couldn't find anything. About an hour later, the Dutch policeman came back to try to score points. Marion had just let them out of the floor because the baby was crying and thought an hour had passed, they were safe. They came out of the floor, Dutch policeman opened the door right there on the thing, and of course, here's Marion, 20 some odd years old, didn't know what to do. A friend had given her a pistol. She said, I'll never use this in my life. I'm a good, she was Anglican at the time, Episcopal. You know, we can't murder. It's against the rules, right? Without hesitation, she picked up the gun and shot the policeman dead on the doorstep to save these people. Her day isn't getting any better. She was hiding Jews, which is a death sentence. She just shot a Dutch policeman. What is she supposed to do next? Well, she had a friend run under curfew to the local undertaker. They arranged it so the next day this policeman would be buried in another casket with another person who had died, two for one, and he disappeared. No one liked the policeman anyway, and no questions were ever asked, so she was safe for another day. She saved hundreds of children throughout the war. There are many, many stories. She's a marvelous woman. But when I talk to her, and I have my little boys I'm considering, and I say, Marion, how do you make just people? She says, Tom, it's pretty easy. Right here I am sitting to Marion listening to this. And she says, it's pretty easy. My mom and dad, when they raised me, they were kind of fun, and we talked a lot. And she said, my dad did not believe in law and order. And suddenly that struck a bell. And of course, I'm thinking, oh no, she's talking about anarchy or something, right? He said, no, my dad believed in justice, which is different. And I think there's something that resonates there, because Germans were really seeking law and order, but not justice. In fact, they were going to give that away. Hitler is named Chancellor in 1933. Why? Because his party was losing votes. They thought they could use him and then get rid of him. After all, he was failing. In times of difficulty or threat, we look for answers, quick solutions, and often find people the scapegoat. Germany in fear, feeling threatened after 9/11. I woke up the next morning thinking of my kids, and for the first time in my life, I was actually terrified. I really was. I couldn't go to sleep at night thinking, what if these people have nuclear weapons? What's the future for my children? And I was terrified. Since then, I've been incredibly alert to what our people and our government has done under the guise of feeling threatened. The Patriot Act. An incredibly scary term. That you are somehow unpatriotic if you criticize the government? That just shivers down my spine. There was a fellow, two stories I can share with you to this effect. One was a fellow, you know, the rice packages the Quakers said sent to the president, right, where, send rice, not bombs, to Iraq. A professor at the University of Virginia, Russian history professor, sent one of those packages. The state police showed up at his door that night with a package saying, did you send this to the president? Yes, I did. You teach Russian history. Are you a communist? Shivers down your spine. And of course, you heard what happened just a few days ago when the Bull Durham anniversary was going to take place, right? You had the 20th anniversary of Bull Durham, and Roberts, I always get his last name wrong, had criticized our president, the conduct of the war. So the whole thing was shut down, and it's not going to be run. And the statement read, you cannot criticize a president in time of war. He's holding our Constitution up and all that kind of thing. And I thought that's what defined Americans. Of course, the fellow who banned him is a fundraiser for the current president. Now, I can make those kind of statements and say, oh, therefore, we're entering Nazi Germany. You know, what I can say, though, is it's my obligation to point out human rights violations as the first and early warning signs of governments that begin to take control where they're not supposed to. So I have to warn you about these civil rights and human rights violations. Did the Nazis plan to murder Jews from the very beginning? It's a very tough question. To deal with it, you need to deal with all these different issues. Mein Kampf, if you read it, Hitler talks about putting Jews to the gas. He was a World War I veteran who suffered from gassing himself. It's in there. You read it, it's a very bizarre book. But on the other hand, Hitler was a very practical and pragmatic politician. When he came to power, he wore a three-piece suit. He knew Germans liked law and order. If you rounded up Jews and gassed them in 1933, they would have thrown him out of power. He was savvy. He waited. The SA versus the SS, we're going to see the brown shirts versus the black shirts. What really was that all about? And what happened was you had these SA brown-shirted thugs who were beating people up on the street, and then Hitler's named Chancellor. They were a tremendous embarrassment to him now that he was trying to establish a legitimate government. And his real problem from 33 to 38 was, how do I rein in the SA, who are rabid anti-Semites who want to attack Jews right now in the streets and still keep my political power? The answer, kill their leaders and create a private army of my own, the SS, who look better, who are college graduated, who have the proper racial background, et cetera, et cetera. So a very savvy fellow. And as you go through the final solution again, ad hoc nature of events, if you go on our website, you'll find a very nice timeline of events with, by the way, two things that I've included. One is, along the way, people who actually did something against the Nazis to see that it was, in fact, possible from the very early stages on. But also, you will see that the events that take place are very ad hoc. When you see, for example, the Nuremberg Laws of 1935, that was written overnight. In 1935, again, this is the idea, was this a pre-planned thing? In fact, it wasn't. There was no way Hitler could have imagined the possibilities that were awaiting him. But in 1935, he was to make a big speech at Nuremberg. The speech was going to be a tremendous announcement about Hitler's first anti-Jewish publicly stated policy. And here's what the big announcement was. It was going to be that German Jews could not fly the Nazi flag over their houses. Hitler thought about it, thought it really didn't have enough bravado behind it. That wouldn't really thrill a lot of people. He called up three lawyers and said, I need something better. Give me a law that excludes Jews from German life. These guys almost had a stroke, right? One guy wrote the law down on the back of a brown paper bag. And the next day at the Nuremberg rallies, Hitler presented it. It was ad hoc, last second thought. And that's going to be true right through 1938. Final solution, basically there were two previous to this. I mentioned exclusion, isolation, and deportation as the first actual policies that would evolve into genocide. What was the Nazi government vision? Now again, this is what Germans would have known. The Nazi platform was very old, widely published, you know. You could see what the platform was. If you want to know what a political party stands for, look at the platform, not what the politician is saying. For when they come to power, their lawyers will take their platform and put it into motion. So if you looked at the Nazi platform, first thing was a biologically pure population. We needed an Aryan stock. And here is where I think it became much more appealing to most Germans. That first one was weird, but this one made more sense. We need to purify society. It's corrupt, it's violent, it's lewd. We need to bring back decency. So purify German society and also propagate a master race that would have these nice values accompanying them because of their racial background. As you see the list of how it evolved, what were the Nazi governmental actions? Identify, classify, discriminate against, and persecute undesirables as defined by the government, and racially dangerous people. And as I evolved this over time, that of course went into combining segregation and expulsion with sterilization and murder. You should know that from 1933 on, Hitler said, we will sterilize handicapped people. We will put them to the gas and get rid of them. That was on the plans. It wasn't implemented until a little bit later, but it was his first idea. And of course, from there came the use of thousands, tens of thousands of bureaucratic experts to implement his policies, whether they be in the army, the party bureaucracy, the different ministries, industry, civil service bureaucracy. You will start to see that it wasn't Hitler and a handful of cronies at the top of the state forcing people to do things, but that a lot of people began to see where the direction was going. And if you wanted advancement in your career, and if you wanted to feed your family, and if you wanted to get tenure at a college, you did what you knew the best thing was to further advance your career. Did that mean they were anti-Semitic? Maybe not. In fact, a terrific ironic story is of Polish rescuers who before the Second World War were highly anti-Semitic. In fact, one woman who had written many tracts about Jews being Christ killers the whole bit became one of the great rescuers in the Second World War. She was anti-Semitic. Nahama Tech, a sociologist who interviewed this woman, said, you know how I found out? No, Nahama, tell me how. Well, I didn't say, do you hate Jews? She said, no, I rescued them during the war. What I said was there anything different about the Jews you rescued? Oh, yes, they were nice Jews. You know, they weren't like all the other Jews. So here was this rescuer who was rescuing Jews who was still anti-Semitic.